Next, I want to move on to talking about how these different types of cognitive impairments and dementias affect the family and what we're calling the primary caregiver. I think many of us know that there are a number of health risks associated with dementia caregiving. There can be a series of negative health outcomes. For example, compromised immune system is very important because many individuals find themselves more susceptible to colds and flus, and they find that it takes longer to recover. There's also several studies now that show in Latinos, as well as in other groups such as Chinese and non-Hispanic whites, dysregulated cortisol is part of the picture. And in chronic caregiving situations, long-term caregiving. And this is important because dysregulated cortisol, in other words, cortisol that does not show the normal diurnal variation, is associated with a number of other significant health conditions. It's not causal, but there is an association, and so we'd rather see that cortisol regulated back to normal diurnal rhythm. Some studies suggest higher rates of type 2 diabetes as well in Latino caregivers. In terms of mental health, depression, frustration, or anger and anxiety are the three most commonly reported negative emotions. Guilt is also high on the list for many caregivers, as well as a pessimistic view of the future. And finally, there are other impacts that have been seen in some studies, but not in all, such as overeating and poor diet, increased social isolation, financial strain on the part of the caregiver, often due to reduced work hours or the inability to work outside the home at all as the disease advances. But I do not want to leave you with the impression that it's all negative, because that is certainly not the case. There are also a number of studies that indicate that caregiving has positive effects on the caregiver, and this is true of Latino caregivers as well. Many report a sense of gratitude, being able to give back to people who took very good care of them earlier in life, and many report that they get a sense of value or worth from caregiving. This slide will show you the conceptual model that we use to help us understand why some caregivers have so much more stress than others, regardless of their race or ethnicity. So we look at several factors. The first, the primary stressors, has to do with the variety of cognitive and behavioral problems that the caregiver is dealing with on a day-to-day basis. The variety, the frequency, the severity. Secondary stressors would include role strain. For example, many Latino caregivers are middle-aged women, somewhere between 40 and 60. Oftentimes they have children, young children, grandchildren, sometimes grown children in the home that they are providing some level of care for. They may be married, they may work outside the home as well. So this can cause a great deal of stress in addition to that which is caused by caregiving itself. And finally, the field is studying more and more the influence of buffering resources. And what we mean by that would be a whole host of factors that seem to indicate, or separate rather, which caregivers have a lot of difficulty, a lot of burden and strain, depression and so forth, and which caregivers have less. So it seems that if there is a strong spiritual network and spiritual support, if there are economic means, if the person has a history of being resilient in the face of stress, if they have a behavioral and cognitive style of coping rather than an avoidance style, and finally, if they are comfortable using technology, these seem to minimize some of the negative effects of caregiving. So many, why this is important is because most of the successful intervention programs that have been aimed at the family have aimed at increasing or improving the quality of these buffering resources, for example, coping styles. Now, evidence-based programs for caregivers, there are many, and it's beyond the scope of this particular course to go into all of them. But my goal is to highlight those that have been developed and tested with Latino caregivers in particular. And there are two large-scale studies, REACH 1 and REACH 2, that involved a Latino, African-American, and Caucasian, non-Hispanic white caregivers in different parts of the country. Another one I'll talk about is the Fotonovela Project that was exclusively for Latino caregivers. I'll also talk about current work that is going on, the Reaching Out study in San Diego, and finally, Proyecto Mirella. So the Coping with Caregiving is a psychoeducational intervention program, and it was developed as part of the Reach One initiative, and it was offered at the Palo Alto, California site of Reach One. Since that time, we have completed over 11 randomized clinical trials and one community-based demonstration project using the Coping with Caregiving format or some variation of it. And the total number of caregivers involved has been quite significant, including about 900 Hispanic Latino caregivers. In general, when the Coping with Caregiving program has been compared to control conditions, such as educational material, support group, treatment as usual, we find that there's greater improvement in the psychoeducational program compared to the others, particularly in reducing symptoms of depression and in having less stress in dealing with common memory and behavior problems. So the program is time limited. It generally ranges from 6 to 12 sessions, depending on a host of factors. The original research was done with actually 13 small group sessions, but for practical reasons, the program has been shortened. It's often 6 to 10 caregivers who attend weekly in a small group. There are detailed agendas for each meeting. There's the opportunity for caregivers to get very involved and to learn some skills by participating actively. So the emphasis in the program is really on enhancing cognitive and behavioral coping skills. Home practice is assigned, and in general, the program has been well received and modified for use in different parts of the country. Some of the skills that are taught on a behavioral level, it's behavior management, how to respond to some of the challenging and complex behaviors that the person with dementia exhibits. We also teach, along with that, a variety of relaxation techniques so as to reduce the overall stress in the situation. Some of the other skills are noted here. Another behavioral one that has been very significant is increasing engagement in everyday positive activities, both for the caregiver himself or herself, and also to share with the person with dementia. Now, we have made some modifications to make this program more attractive to Latino caregivers, and one of the biggest ones is to introduce the use of platicar, or social conversation, at the beginning of the meetings. We clarify when we teach behavior management that what we're trying to do is help the caregiver become more effective in her role. Same with increasing positive activities. It's not to make the person feel good, but it's to help them do a better job with caregiving. So in this slide, we see that in the Reach One study at Palo Alto, we enrolled 122 non-Hispanic white and 91 Latino caregivers. Reduced depressive symptoms and burden were found for both groups, and one-year follow-up indicated that gains were maintained. So this was one of the first studies to indicate that a psychoeducational approach could really help Latino caregivers. And the program has been translated into several other languages. Besides Spanish, we also have it in Chinese, Japanese, and Farsi. And there have been trials in which the Coping with Caregiving program has been used with these other ethnic groups as well. Now, Reach 2 is the largest study, largest randomized clinical trial with diverse caregivers in the U.S. to date. There were 650 individual caregivers enrolled in 5 sites, including, again, the Palo Alto, California site. This project involved home visits, about 10 of them, along with a telephone support group over 6 months. It incorporated some features of the coping with caregiving and other features from other intervention programs that were used at different Reach One sites. The active treatment was compared to a control condition, a minimal control condition, and an omnibus overall measure of quality of life was used as the outcome. Now, the greatest improvement was found in Latino caregivers. They showed much more significant, statistically significant improvement from pre to post evaluation compared to the other groups. The Caucasian caregivers significantly improved, but the effect was not as great. And African American caregiver spouses improved, but daughters did not. And that finding is being studied further. We also found in Reach 2 that rates of clinical depression were lower among caregivers in the active intervention, that was across race and ethnicity, and lower rates of nursing home placement for caregivers in the active intervention. However, these particular results did not reach statistical significance, but were trends. Now, Reaching Out program in San Diego is a unique program. It was funded by the County of San Diego, the Weinberg Institute, and the Rosalind Carter Institute. And it is a partnership between Stanford and the Southern Caregiver Resource Center, a community-based agency serving caregivers in San Diego County. The core features of Reach 1 and Reach 2 were modified or tailored for the primarily low-income, low health literacy, immigrant Latino communities in Southern San Diego and Imperial counties. These communities have large numbers of Latinos, but they've never before been approached for services of this kind. So we had a total of over 400 participants enroll in this approximately 3-year period of active enrollment. They received a modification of either the small group Reach One psychoeducational program or the in-home based Reach Two program. All identified as Latino, and most were women over the age of 45. And here is a good example of the results. The cutoff score of 16 was used to indicate significant symptoms of depression. And we see that at the baseline assessment, over 50% of the caregivers reported a score of 16 or greater, whereas at the, which is represented by the orange colored cylinder, whereas at the post-assessment or the reassessment, which took place approximately 6 months later, that number was reduced to under 15%. So these are promising results in this particular program. The Savvy Caregiver program is one that I would like to mention because it has been widely used and it is in current use by the National Alzheimer's Association. So the Savvy Caregiver program is also one that is skill-based. It focuses on training in cognitive and behavioral skills and alerting the caregiver to self-care issues. It consists of 12 hours of training delivered in 2-hour sessions over 6 weeks, and it is definitely available in Spanish as well as in English. There's a detailed trainer's manual, a caregiver manual, a videotape, and a CD-ROM. So it was expanded and field tested in Minnesota, where it was originally developed, and several tests of its efficacy have found that caregivers who were in the Savvy Caregiving condition compared to those in a control condition reported increased knowledge, skills, and confidence. All of them would recommend it to others, and it was recently used with Latinos in Texas, so it's getting a broad use, and it is now being used, as I say, recommended by the National Alzheimer's Association. The next one is the Fotonovela project. The Fotonovela is 20 pages in Spanish and 20 in English. A fotonovela is considered a culturally appropriate way to deliver health-related information. It is a picture book with a dramatic storyline, photos of real actors depicting real-life scenes to illustrate key points and teach some skills. We base the content on the prior work that I've been describing, plus also input from 12 focus groups with both providers and family caregivers. And this project was funded by the Alzheimer's Association. This is a sample of what it looks like. Together we can face memory loss as a family. It is downloadable free at the site given below on the slide. It describes the story of the Jimenez family, first getting the diagnosis and then handling caregiver stress and dealing with some safety concerns. Various coping strategies are depicted, such as using distraction, seeking support, and participating in a family meeting. And finally, there are tips on taking care of yourself as a caregiver, and there's a depression checklist so that if that turns out to be significant, the person can seek help for that. We did conduct a randomized trial comparing the photonovella to usual educational materials and found a significant decrease in depressive symptoms for those who were active in the photonovella condition compared to those who received only the printed educational materials that were downloadable from a website. There was no significant difference in their stress reaction to their care recipients' memory and behavior problems. But the photonovella was described as having greater reach, namely it was shared with more family members compared to the other materials, and it was rated significantly more helpful. The ongoing project is Proyecto Mirela, or a web novella study that is funded by the National Institute on Aging under an SBIR grant. Our initial goal was to develop a short online soap opera entirely in Spanish, and that has now been achieved. We have 18 episodes of 15 to 20 minutes each, using again a dramatic storyline to show how a family copes with dementia-related changes in their beloved grandmother and what can be done to reduce burden and help the family as a unit deal with these challenges. The primary caregiver is Mirela, and the randomized trial is now underway to assess the efficacy in improving well-being, reducing depressive symptoms, and decreasing perceived stress. Now, the plot of Mirela, 18 episodes featuring the Lopez family, and the characters include Maribel, who is the grandmother for the person with dementia, Mirela, the primary caregiver, and her husband, Mario, their oldest daughter, Gracia, their younger daughter, Esperanza, Gracia's boyfriend, and Mirela's brother, who lives and works out of state in Arizona. In this family, the grandmother develops dementia and difficult things start to happen. We see the family struggling with these situations, but they do sort things out over time and they come up with some good solutions to some of their common problems. But in the end, they realize that dementia is not curable. They need to accept the fact that it is present, but they need to continue to create opportunities to live with it and to comfort and love one another. That's our summary of the Mirela plot. Enrollment is now open. This slide gives information about how to enroll in the project and what number to call for further information. Enrollment will continue through the end of the year 2015 and most likely into June of 2016. I want to thank you for your attention. Please feel free to contact me with questions that you might have regarding the course material, and please feel free to consult the website of the Stanford Geriatric Education Center for further information about our programs and services, specifically those geared to Latino communities.